Joining me now is Alexis Bloom, director of Divide and Conquer, the story of Roger Ailes. And there are a number of things I want to talk about here, Alexis. One is how important Roger Ailes was. Two is how disgusting Roger Ailes was. And three is what made Roger Ailes what he is. So let's start with the disgusting part. Now, first, actually, give us a background on who he is generally. Then I want to move on to what he did in the case of sexual harassment, assault, and Kelly Boyle's a decent example of that. We'll go to that. But first, for people unfamiliar with Roger Ailes, who is he?
Roger Ailes is best known, I guess, as the founder of Fox News. He started Fox News in 1996 with Rupert Murdoch and was very much the sort of creative brain behind Fox News. Murdoch was the money and Roger was the sort of ideology and the design. But he's had, you know, a career that precedes that that's very important to understand. He was a big Republican sort of campaign manager. He helped elect, arguably, Nixon, Reagan, George H.W. Bush. He was kind of a Republican sort of message maestro and a really tough guy. If you wanted to sort of play hardball, you got Roger on your team. You know, he was also friends with kind of that whole Black Manafort and Stone cabal. Yeah, he was also less well-known, a big entertainer, worked on the Mike Douglas show, had his own talk show on the channel that preceded MSNBC. So he was a man who kind of melded entertainment and political conflict. And that was best illustrated by Fox.
Yeah, so there's a lot of stories about how he orchestrated things dating all the way back to Richard Nixon. And I remember one story that came out of a memo that was unearthed fairly recently where he told Nixon, look, this is how you light a Christmas tree. You don't want to just hand it off to the kids because it'll be disempowering. You also don't want to ignore the kids that are in the Christmas tree lighting because then people will not think that you're caring about them and empathetic. So you bring the kid on and you press the button with him while he's on your lap. Gives you a sense of how much he choreographed the Republican Party before he was on Fox News, and then of course choreographed it when he was on Fox News itself. So now let's go to who he is as a person. So tell us the story about Kelly Boyle. Who was she and what was his interaction with Roger Ailes?
I mean, many of the women in the film who were harassed by Roger Ailes, but just regular women who came across his path. You know, I have to say that it's not a story of Republicans against Democrats. You know, it's not really, I try not to be crazily overtly political because it's much bigger than that. It's a tale about morality, you know, and the politics kind of fits into that, but it's not about Republicanism, it's about morality. And this is very clearly sort of writ because, you know, the women that he harassed were also Republicans. Kelly was a Republican sort of strategist and consultant who met him, who loved his book. He'd written a great book called You Are the Message that was sort of a self-help book. It was also a book about PR and how to present yourself. And he said he would coach her and took her out for dinner and then, you know, delivered this incredibly cheesy but actually ultimately very destructive line, if you want to play with the big boys, you better lay with the big boys. And when she declined, he sort of summarily ended her career. So she's sort of exemplary of the ordinary sort of person that he encountered, somebody who's hardworking, who admired him, and who sort of came across this very transactional nature of Roger, and also his very sort of punitive bent. She refused his advances and, you know, I mean, thought nothing more of it. And then when the appointments she'd made with the Republican National Committee all sort of disappeared into the vapor, she realized that Roger, you know, had said, you know, to her, this is the way the game is played, Kelly. And it turned out that was the way the game was played.
Yeah.
And ended her career. I mean, she then went on to have children and launched a different career, thank God. But, you know, it kind of, in cricket terms, you know, it knocked her for six. And it showed what kind of man he was, personally.
No, yeah, he's a monster. I'll tell you the other part of the Kelly Boyle story that you highlight, is she asks almost facetiously, obviously, because she didn't accept his advance or any other advances, would I have to be anyone else's special friend? He replies, yeah. Well, you might have to give a few blowjobs here and there, but everyone will know you're with me. Monster, through yeah. and through. And there's yeah. the stories when he was working on the Michael Douglas show as a producer, where he takes out his genitalia and chases women around the room.
Yeah, and he also said to a woman who he made a pass at the Mike Douglas show, I mean, make a pass at it is too light a term, but, you know, who he propositioned kind of aggressively, he said, you know, you're going to have to please a few of my friends. That seemed to be a common motif. It's like not only me, but, you know, it's other people too.
So when he met Nixon, it was through the Mike Douglas show. So yeah. can you walk us through what happened there? Because this is his transition now to politics.
Yeah. I mean, it's happenstance, and he's a great opportunist, Roger. He is working on the Mike Douglas show. Nixon comes in, you know, to appear on the show because all the best and brightest sort of at that time, authors, entertainers, politicians, they all appeared on the Mike Douglas show. And when he meets Nixon, he says, you're going to lose again. If you don't understand television, use television, harness television, you're going to lose. And Nixon thinks, you know, who's this upstart? Who's this, like, you know, pushy young guy? And I like him. And he says, well, come work for me. And Roger goes, you know, I sure will, and leads the Mike Douglas show. And that's his transition. That's his springboard, basically. But Roger was never one to let, you know, an opportunity slip away from him.
And he writes it for Nixon, this memo called A Plan to Put the GOP on TV. Oh,
yeah.
I mean, it's almost like an initial rough draft of what he wound up doing at Fox News. So yeah. What did that memo say?
I mean, it's not clear, I have to say, just for fact, it's not clear that he did write it. His handwriting is all over it in the notes. He clearly worked on it, and he, you know, we know that he helped strategize this plan, but we don't know, you know, history's intriguing. We don't know who else did, and, you know, was Haldeman the author of the original memo? We don't know. But Roger wanted to be the driver behind this. And the idea was that Roger would provide the cameras, the logistics, and the know-how to get Republican messaging out into the sort of middle of America and bypass the coasts, bypass Los Angeles, bypass New York in terms of media, and get the Republican message straight into the heartland. So it wouldn't have to go through a filter. You know, they considered the mainstream media very antagonistic, and they wanted to provide local news stations with Republican messaging directly. So Roger proposed that he would get, you know, congressmen, senators to provide their messaging. He would put it on tape, he would put it on planes, and he would fly it directly overnight to local news stations, and they would broadcast it. And local news stations would be grateful for it, because at that stage, you know, content was incredibly expensive, and they'd be delighted to have it for free.
Yeah, so they wanted to bypass the traditional media because they did fact checking. Roger Ailes, in that sense, is the creator of fake news. So you get the Republican propaganda and you just deliver it through TV straight to the audience without having to go through journalists. In fact, yeah. he has an interesting quote about journalism here. He apparently said, I didn't know he had said this. I found out, you know, through researching what you had done. If you want to have, he told Charlie Rose, if you want to have tremendous political influence and still be a womanizer, drug abuser, or an alcoholic, you only have one choice of career, and that's journalism, because journalists won't attack each other. They only attack all the rest of us, and anybody who denies it is lying. And yeah. Isn't that exactly what happened with Fox News? CNN, MSNBC immediately bring the cavalry to protect Fox News, because one day they might have a job at Fox News.
Yeah. I mean, that whole set, that is, that's, I mean, it's just also dripping in irony, though, because what happened with Charlie Rose? So it's the two of them having this exchange, you know, in our film, and Roger's going to him, you know, oh, Charlie, you know, if you want to be a bad boy and a womanizer and, you know, you got to be in journalism. And Charlie goes, ha, 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 ha. But, you know, and he's ultimately outed as a kind of a womanizer and serial sexual harasser himself. So
didn't he also once refer to conservatives with the red meat they throw out there on Fox News as riling up the crazies?
Yeah, he did. He said, you know, that was their job. He was very blunt about not being a journalist.
Yeah.
You know, he had no respect for journalism.
And he doesn't even respect his own audience. He doesn't respect, you know, Republican voters. He just says these are suckers. In the original memo, he in his handwriting talks about people are lazy. Just feed them the news and they'll get, you know, you show them pretty girls with see-through desks and make sure they're wearing skirts and they'll believe anything. And so he has no, okay, last thing here, because this is amazing and also did not know until I got familiar with your work. About his dad. So this seems to have originated from his dad and all the crazy things he did. So about not trusting anybody, the bunk bed story. There's so many stories about his dad that seem so outrageous. Can you just give us a sense of it?
I mean, he had a very troubled childhood. You know, I'm no psychoanalyst, but, you know, people with, you know, enormous kind of difficulties in later years often do come from places of conflict. And he had, you know, major issues with both of his parents. He was a, you know, he, I mean, on the record, he says, you know, I never remember my mother giving me a hug. You know, I think she felt guilty about the disease I had because it's passed down the matrimonial line, the sort of female kind of genetic line, because he had hemophilia. So he was very, very sick as a child. He had a lot of brushes with death. He was in hospital for months on months repeatedly. And, you know, he came from a background, I mean, his parents got divorced. They didn't tell him when he was away in college. And they sold the house and gave his stuff away. And when he was an adult, he always talked about that. You know, I'm really pissed about that because, you know, I had my collections and stuff. Why didn't they tell me? He actually learned from his grandmother that they had sold the house and his stuff was gone. His father, I don't want to give it away, but there's this whole story he tells about his father. But it turns out to be apocryphal. He had a very bad... well, he had a very difficult upbringing, you know, punctuated by this hemophilia, but he did mythologize this, he aggrandized this, and he sort of embellished it in ways that are strange and telling, you know, to make himself even more of a victim than he already was.
Look, the movie is telling in so many different ways. And when he talks about his mom and saying, "Say my condition is passed on through women," you could just feel the disdain in those words. And you know, and everybody check it out. It's called "Divide and Conquer: The Story of Roger Ailes." You can the website's divideandconquerfilm.com. And this guy, unfortunately, was I think the single most powerful man in America for decade after decade. And I've been saying that for the whole 17 years the Young Turks has been on. And I couldn't believe that other people couldn't see it. So, and when you see the story, it's the story, in my opinion, of an American psycho and how he took control of the country.
Yeah, so it's not much different now that he's gone, unfortunately.
Yes, I mean, he handed off to another psycho. So on and on it goes. All right, Alexis Bloom, the director of the movie, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for watching this free clip of the Young Turks. Don't forget to become a TYT member today. For more exclusive content, join now at tyt.com/join.